We welcome everyone on our 18-day course for children, going to be presented by His Grace Gaurang Darshan Prabhu. So I'm sure many of you all know about Prabhuji, and for those who don't, Prabhuji is a spiritual author, he's a Shastric teacher, and he's the Dean of BVRC at ISKCON GEV. We all know that Prabhuji's books, the Subodhani series of study guides, has been so, so helpful to many of us. And Prabhuji runs a monthly e-magazine also, which is called Bhagavat Pradapika. And he regularly writes articles on spiritual subjects. And we are so, so fortunate to have Prabhuji do this for children. This is the first time he's doing something for kids, and we are as excited as all of you. And so is Prabhuji to do this for kids. And Prabhuji is also on the path of doing a beautiful Bhagavatam series for kids also, which we will be launching soon. Prabhuji is writing books, a series of 5 books for children on Bhagavatam, where the entire Bhagavatam will be covered. So a lot of plans on for children. So do stay tuned. And thank you, Prabhuji. We are very grateful that you can do this for our children. So with this, over to you, Prabhuji. Thank you.
Thank you, Madhuji. I welcome all the children who have enthusiastically come to participate in this course on Bhagavad Gita. It really brings great pleasure to my heart to see so many little children eager to learn Bhagavad Gita and our scriptures. And I also offer my respects and congratulate the parents of all these children who encouraged the eagerness of all these children to learn Bhagavad Gita. So we will start. In the next 18 sessions, we will be covering the 18 chapters of Bhagavad Gita. And some chapters of Bhagavad Gita are a little longer, some are smaller. Sometimes I may take one chapter in 1.5 or 2 sessions. Like 9 chapters is very important. And also there are few chapters which are very small. So those chapters I will kind of summarize. And I will try to explain the content of Bhagavad Gita with some stories also, so that all the children can easily relate with the contents of the chapter. So let's start our journey into Srimad Bhagavad Gita. I hope all of you are excited enough. So I'll be showing you a PPT also, so that you can note some points and follow the contents easily. So thank you. So let's start. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Hare Krishna. Srimad Bhagavad Gita is considered very foundational spiritual book for all the devotees, because the basic philosophy of our Vaishnavism is very wonderfully recorded in Bhagavad Gita. And Bhagavad Gita is a scripture, but it is very special scripture because this is directly spoken by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna. So Krishna directly spoke. Several scriptures are written by Vyasadeva. So Vyasadeva has written 4 Vedas and 18 Puranas, and also he wrote Upanishads, Mahabharata, so many things he has written. So, and this Bhagavad Gita also comes as a part of Mahabharata, but these, in the 700 shlokas of Bhagavad Gita, maximum shlokas were spoken by Krishna. So Krishna is directly speaking to us. We are all Krishna's children. And our Supreme Father, with so much of love and affection, he is speaking to us directly, giving us some suggestions on how to live our life, how to conduct ourselves properly. All that Krishna speaks in Bhagavad Gita. So it's a very special scripture for us, because we get to hear directly from our Supreme Father Krishna. So in this Bhagavad Gita, Krishna teaches us how to eat, how to recreate, how to interact with other people, how to worship him, all those things Krishna teaches us. And let's begin the first chapter. The first chapter of Bhagavad Gita teaches us the confusion of Arjuna. So now, before entering the chapter, let me give you a very quick outline of the background of Bhagavad Gita. Now, in what context Bhagavad Gita is spoken? The first chapter of Bhagavad Gita is entitled Observing the Armies. Who observes the armies? Arjuna observes the armies. Where? On the battlefield of Kurukshetra. So now let's see a few incidents that happened that are in connection with Bhagavad Gita. There are 5 Pandavas and there are 100 Kauravas. So there were 2 brothers, Pandu Maharaj and Dhritarashtra Maharaj. So Pandu had 5 sons. You know who are they, Pandavas? They are Yudhishthir, Bhima, Arjuna, Nakula, and Sahadeva. And Dhritarashtra had 100 sons. They were Dushyasana, Duryodhana. I'll not tell the remaining 98 names. So first 2 names and remaining plus 98. Okay. So like that, these are 100 brothers and these are 5 brothers. So they both were born from 2 brothers, Pandu and Dhritarashtra. So, the kingdom of Hastinapur must be shared amongst these 2 groups of brothers properly. But Duryodhan wanted the entire kingdom for his own self. And Dhritarashtra, who was the father of Duryodhan, was supporting the mentality of Duryodhan. And he also is very greedy for the kingdom of Hastinapur. And he wanted Duryodhan only to take over the kingdom of Hastinapur. He does not want to give any share to our Pandu's sons, Pandavas. Okay. So since their childhood only, this Duryodhan, Dushyasan, and Karna, Shakuni, supported by Dhritarashtra, they tried to harm the Pandavas in various ways. When Bhima was a small child, this Duryodhan, Dushyasan, all these people gave poison to Bhima and threw him in a lake. So, but somehow by Krishna's grace, Bhima survived. And when these Pandavas grew up, so in a gambling match, this Duryodhan, Dushyasan, Karna, Shakuni, and all these Kauravas have cheated these Pandavas and they have taken their kingdom. In a gambling match, they cheated them and then they took over their kingdom completely. Not only that, they insulted their wife. This Dushyasan dragged Draupadi. You know, Draupadi is the queen of the Pandavas. And Dushyasan dragged Draupadi into this assembly and he tried to disrobe her. He tried to pull away her sari. But the Supreme Lord Krishna came and provided unlimited sari and protected Draupadi. So in this way, in various ways, this Kauravas tried to trouble the Pandavas and kill them, take away their kingdom, insult them in various ways. Now, after this gambling match, these Pandavas went to the forest. Okay, they went to the forest because according to the gambling match, they lost the gambling match. Whoever is the loser has to go to the forest and stay there for 12 years. Okay, and 1 more year also they have to stay incognito at a different place. No one should be able to understand where these Pandavas were staying. So they have to just hide themselves. They have to hide their identities. So like that 13 years, these Pandavas spent their time in the forest and the different places. After 13 years, they came back to Hastinapur and they wanted their kingdom back. But this Duryodhan was not at all willing to give the kingdom back. And even Krishna also went to Hastinapur and spoke to Dhritarashtra and Duryodhan and other people He requested that, my dear Duryodhan, please give the rightful kingdom of Pandavas back to them. If you can't give half the kingdom, at least give them 5 villages. But Duryodhan was so proud, so arrogant, so selfish in nature, very greedy for the kingdom. Duryodhan did not give the kingdom back. Duryodhan said that, I cannot give the kingdom back. If they want, let them come for a war. So this is the context in which Bhagavad Gita is spoken. So these 5 Pandavas and these 100 Kauravas and their supporters, supporters of each party. So they all gathered together and they assembled at a place, holy place called Kurukshetra, and they were about to fight now. Whoever wins the fight will get the kingdom. So this is the background story. All this happened about 5,000 years back. Fine. So now let's enter Bhagavad Gita. I just give a very quick context in which Bhagavad Gita was spoken. So in the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita, we will see 5 topics. Topic number 1, Dhritarashtra, because he was blind, he cannot go to the battle and fight. So he was sitting in Hastinapur kingdom only. Dhritarashtra had a secretary named Sanjaya. So he asked Sanjaya about the scene on the battlefield. We'll discuss elaborately. Okay, that's first topic. Dhritarashtra's question to Sanjaya is the first topic. Second topic, Duryodhan compares the armies. His own army and Pandava's army, he compares. That's the second topic we are going to discuss today. Third topic, all the warriors on the battle, they blow conch shells. And that blowing of conch shells indicate the victory of Pandavas. That's the third topic. Then fourth topic, Arjuna becomes confused. And fifth topic, Arjuna gives several reasons not to fight in the war. So this is the subject matter of the first chapter. Clear? So what I, these 5 topics we are going to discuss for the next 1 hour. So let's begin with the first topic. So I hope all of you are clear so far. I just spoke the storyline, the background of Bhagavad Gita, and now we will see more details. So Bhagavad Gita begins with Dhritarashtra's inquiry to Sanjaya. Who is this Sanjaya? Sanjaya was a minister of our Dhritarashtra. And you see in this picture, there is, this is Dhritarashtra, the blind king, and this is Sanjaya. And Sanjaya is a student of Vyasadeva, and by the blessings of Vyasadeva, who has written all the scriptures, he received a special power by which he can envision what's happening on the battlefield of Kurukshetra while sitting in the palace. Sanjaya was sitting in the palace, but he could understand what's happening in the battlefield. So because Dhritarashtra cannot go to the war field, the battlefield, he was sitting in the kingdom, and he was telling Sanjaya, Sanjaya, you are able to see what's happening in the battlefield. Can you please tell me what's happening there? You are able to visualize, you are able to see everything. Now I am sitting in my room and you are sitting in your houses. You are able to see what I am doing here. I am able to see what you are doing there. Okay. Yeah, some people are writing notes. So I am able to see you. So now in those days, these Zoom calls were not there. These video cameras were not there. But there's a divine vision. This Sanjaya had a divine vision. He got some special blessings of Vyasadeva, and he had a divine vision. In his vision, he can see what's happening in the battlefield of Kurukshetra. So Sanjaya was envisioning and narrating everything to Dhritarashtra. So now Dhritarashtra first asked, the first shloka of Bhagavad Gita. Dhritarashtra uvacha. Now, if you can, you can also recite along with me at your own house. Dharma kshetre kurukshetre samaveta yutsavahan mamakah pandavas chaiva kimakurvata sanjaya. The meaning of the shloka is, Dharma Kshetre, in a holy place called Kurukshetre. So the holy place of pilgrimage where this Kurukshetra war is happening is very spiritual place. Samaveta Yuyutsavaha. Samaveta means all these Pandavas and Kauravas have been assembled there. And to do what? Yuyutsavaha. Yu means Yuddha, means war. So with a great enthusiasm to fight with each other, Pandavas and Kauravas have assembled at a holy place called Kurukshetra. And now you see Dhritarashtra says, Mamakaha means my sons, Pandavaha, Pandu sons, Jaiva. Now you see the selfishness of Dhritarashtra. Pandavas are Pandu sons and Kauravas are my sons. That's why he said, Mamakaha Pandavas Jaiva. Kim akurvata Sanjaya? Oh Sanjaya, what did they do? What did they do after assembling in the battlefield? Now, for example, after this class, your mother will give you food. Okay. So in front of you, a plate is put, a chapati, some rice, some sabji, some dal is kept, and water is kept. Maybe some mango juice is also kept. After all the food is kept in front of you, what will you do? You will eat, isn't it? It's such an obvious question. It's a redundant question. Okay, what did so-and-so child do after the mother fed him, mother kept food in front of the child? So he will eat. Similarly, after Pandavas and Kauravas assemble on the battlefield of Kurukshetra to fight, what will they do? They will fight. But Dhritarashtra asked this redundant question, this actually unnecessary question, useless question, right? When they assemble to fight, they will fight. Right, it's natural. You don't need to ask about it specifically, but still he asked. There's a reason. You may think that it's a stupid question, but it's a very intelligent question. Okay, why did he ask like that? There are four reasons. Now you see, you're able to see the screen, you're able to see the shloka. See in the left corner, greedy. Dhritarashtra was greedy for the kingdom. So when he asked this question, that question shows how greedy is he for the kingdom. He wanted the entire kingdom for his own self or his sons. And now he was doubtful whether his sons are going to win the war and get the kingdom for themselves. So he had doubts on his own sons. Oh, this Duryodhan, Dushyasan, they are definitely powerful warriors, but still I'm not sure. I'm not sure whether they will be able to kill Pandavas and get the kingdom for them. So he was doubtful. Next, he was fearful also. Why he was fearful? Because Kurukshetra was a holy place, right? It's a very holy place. And he was thinking that because of being in a holy place, my sons, these 100 Kauravas, might change their mind. They may give up their intention to fight only. So because of the influence of holy place, they may stop fighting, they may transform their heart, they may realize that, oh, we have done so much of injustice to the Pandavas, it's not appropriate, we are doing so many sins, let's stop this war. So Dhritarashtra does not want his sons to become transformed like that. He wanted them to fight, and he wanted them to win, and he wanted the kingdom for himself. But he had doubts whether they will be able to win or not. So he was hopeful. He was hoping. What was his hope? He was hoping that because of the influence of holy place, Pandavas can compromise, right? Because of the influence of holy place, Pandavas should come in front of the Kauravas and say, we don't want this kingdom, take this back. Right, take this kingdom back. So Dhritarashtra had these four things in mind. He had greed, he had doubts, he had fears, and he had hopes. Okay, he was greedy for the kingdom. Is it clear? He was greedy for the kingdom. He was doubtful whether his sons will be able to fight or not. And he was fearful that his sons might compromise. And he was hopeful that Pandavas should compromise and get the kingdom for himself. Now see, this person, this Dhritarashtra, was so selfish that he already had 100 sons and his brother Pandu had 5 more sons. So can't he think his 5 sons also as his own sons? I have 100 sons, my brother have 5 sons. So all put together, we have 105 sons. Dhritarashtra could have made Pandavas also into his sons. He would have given them that love and affection and care, but he did not do that. He was so selfish. On the other hand, if we compare this Dhritarashtra with Kunti Devi, you know who is Kunti? Kunti is the mother of the 5 Pandavas. Actually, Kunti was the mother of only 3 of the Pandavas. Yudhishthir, Bhima, and Arjuna were the sons of Kunti Maharani. But Nakula and Sahadeva were the sons of Kunti's co-wife, Madri. Pandu Maharaj had 2 wives. You are able to follow? Pandu Maharaj had 2 wives, Kunti, Madri. From Kunti, he got 3 sons, Yudhishthir, Bhima, and Arjuna. And from Madri, he got 2 sons, Nakula and Sahadeva. So when Pandu Maharaj died, Madri also died with him. So when Madri died, Kunti Maharani accepted the 2 sons of Madri and considered that she always had 5 sons. Her 3 sons and Madri's 2 sons, total 5 sons. So Kunti Maharani was very selfless that she accepted the 2 sons of her co-wife as her own sons and always said that I have 5 sons. But Dhritarashtra was so selfish that he could not accept Pandu's 5 sons as his own sons. He always felt that I have 100 sons and Pandu has 5 sons. These 5 sons should die. All the kingdom should come for my sons only. That is the selfish nature of this Dhritarashtra. So, but Kunti Maharani is a very broad-minded, pure devotee of the Lord. So that's why Kunti is better. Now, you may think that why Krishna did not kill the Kauravas? Okay, if Kauravas are so bad, they were so selfish, and if they are, they have done so many atrocities, so many sinful activities, and if they have troubled the Pandavas in various ways, why Krishna did not kill the Kauravas? He could have killed them. But the reason why Krishna did not personally kill the Kauravas is that Krishna wanted to give credit to his devotees. You understand? Krishna loves to give credit to his devotees. In the Kurukshetra war, Krishna did not fight personally. What was he doing? All of you know. You're able to see the picture also, right? So all the, this Krishna was just playing the role of a chariot driver. He was just driving the chariot of his devotee Arjuna. So he was playing the role of chariot driver, but he did not personally kill the Kauravas. Why? Because he wanted to enable Bhima, Arjuna and other Pandavas to kill the demons, right? Demoniac people like Dushyasana, Duryodhana, Karna, Shakuni, all these people, right? So Krishna wanted to give that credit to the devotees. So he killed so many demons. Krishna killed, as all of you must be knowing, Krishna as a small child only, as an infant baby, he killed Putana. As a 3-month-old baby, he killed Shakatasura. As 1-year-old child, he killed Trinavarta. As 6-year-old boy, he subdued Kalya. As 7-year-old boy, he lifted this great mountain of Govardhan, and he killed Arishtasura, Vyomasura, Aghasura, so many demons he has killed, right? But can't Krishna kill Duryodhan, Dushyasana, Karna, Shakuni? These are very insignificant people in comparison to Aghasura, Vatsasura, Vyomasura. They are more powerful demons. But Krishna wanted to give the credit of killing these demoniac people to his devotee Arjuna, to his devotee Bhima. So he's just guiding them. He's just giving them advice. He was playing the role of a chariot driver and an advisor and guiding the Pandavas in fighting the Kurukshetra war. That's why he did not kill Kauravas, right? Because Krishna likes to see his devotees more glorified than himself. Now, actually, in this religious field of Kurukshetra, through the Pandavas, Krishna is only uprooting the sons of Dhritarashtra. Now you see, have you seen this agriculture field? Next time when you come to GEV, you may be able to see. So now, in an agriculture field, the farmers might plant this rice plants, right? Along with the rice plants, sometimes some unnecessary plants grow. Those unnecessary plants are called weeds, okay? So when these weeds grow, they suck all the water and fertilizers provided to the rice crop. So the farmer has to remove the weeds. So farmer has to remove the weeds, and he should not keep the weeds there growing along with the rice crop. So similarly, in this religious field of this Kurukshetra, Krishna acts like a farmer. He removes the weeds of Dhritarashtra's sons, and he will nourish Pandavas, because Pandavas are virtuous people, righteous people, dharmic devotees. So they are supposed to survive, not Kauravas. Noble people like Pandava should rule the kingdom of Hastinapur, not evil people like Duryodhan, Dushasan, etc. Right? So it's Krishna only who is going to kill these Dhritarashtra's sons, but through Pandavas, through Bhima. Okay? So that's about the first shloka. Now let's get into the second section, second topic of our discussion today. So Duryodhan compares the armies. Now on the side of Pandavas, Krishna was there. So Krishna, you know who is the Supreme Lord, right? That is Krishna. So Krishna is the source of all incarnations. Okay. So Krishna now is going to guide Pandavas in such a way that they will win the war of Kurukshetra. Now Duryodhan became quite astonished to see the extent of the armies of Pandavas, because Pandavas for the last 13 years they were in the forests, but still Pandavas managed to get thousands and thousands of armies on their side, and Duryodhan was astonished and he was a little fearful. So Duryodhan went to this Dronacharya. You know who is Dronacharya, right? Dronacharya is the military teacher of both Pandavas and Kauravas. So this Duryodhan went to Dronacharya and started speaking. He started comparing his own army and Pandava's army. He said that, "My dear teacher, in my army, there are several great personalities like yourself, Bhishma, Karna, Kripa, Ashwatthama. Like there are so many people I have on my side. Similarly, there are some great warriors on Pandava's side also. Who are they? Bhima, Arjuna, Drupada, Abhimanyu, Virata. So these are some of the warriors who were fighting on the side of Pandavas. So this Duryodhan was comparing these two armies, right? He was comparing this army and that army, and he was internally experiencing some fear. He was thinking that, oh my God, somehow they managed to get so much army. I'm not sure whether I will be able to win them or not. Although I have some great warriors on my side like Bhishma and Drona, still I'm not sure whether it is possible for me to defeat these Pandavas. He was having some inner great warriors that I spoke about while speaking to you. There are many other warriors also in my field. Anye cha bahavasura madarthe tyakta jeevitah nana shastra praharanah sarve yuddha visharadah. So I'll not dwell on so many Sanskrit shlokas, don't worry. Okay, so here one line we'll discuss. Madarthe tyakta jeevitah means this Duryodhan was telling Dronacharya, "My dear guru, my dear teacher, there are so many warriors who came to fight on my behalf. Madarthe tyakta jeevitah, they were ready to give up their lives for my sake." Okay, so by saying this, Duryodhan indicated that all those people who came to support me are going to die. Indirectly, he indicated that whoever comes to support me will die. Okay, so like that, Duryodhan was expressing his inner fears while speaking to Dhritarashtra. Dronacharya. Now he also compares between the chief warriors on his side and Pandava's side. Who is the chief warrior on the side of Pandavas? Bhima. He's so powerful. Bhima is known to eat so much. Okay. And he is known to kill so many people. Right. He's a very powerful warrior. He even killed great demons like Hidimbasura. So the main warrior on the side of Pandavas was Bhima. and the main warrior on the side of Kauravas was Bhishma. So Bhishma was a very powerful warrior. So Bhishma was the great grandsire of this Kuru dynasty, and Bhishma's power knew no bounds. Bhishma is such a great personality. So now Bhishma is more experienced than Bhima. So our Duryodhan was trying to encourage his own self, saying that our army is better situated than their army because we have a more experienced leader called Bhishma and they have a less experienced military general called Bhima. So we are better. Okay. So Duryodhan was comparing both the armies. Is it clear? Mm-hmm. So now that's the second section. So now let's get into the third section. So third section talks about blowing of conchs. Okay. So, and these conchs show signs of victory for the Pandavas. Now this Duryodhan, as he was speaking to Dronacharya and he also was looking at Bhishma. So Bhishma, to encourage his grandson Duryodhan, he started blowing his conch. Okay, Bhishma blew his conch. So now you see, Bhishma blew his conch shell. That indicated victory for the Pandavas. How is it? Because so whenever you perform aarti, so if there you have seen a pujari performing aarti in the temple or you performing aarti at houses. So before performing aarti, the pujari blows conch shell. You know that? Pujari blows conch shell. So blowing conch shell means beginning worship of Vishnu. So Bhishma blew his conch shell, means he is going to worship Krishna, who is on the other side. Okay. And this blowing of conch shell is very auspicious for all the devotees of Krishna. Okay. And who are the devotees of Krishna? Pandavas, not Kauravas. So Bhishma is a devotee and Pandavas are devotees. Although Bhishma was fighting from the side of Duryodhan, still, Bhishma was blowing conch shell and he was worshipping Krishna. Okay. So, in this way, Bhishma's blowing of conch shell indicated the victory for Pandavas. Now, let us recite one shloka. Tataha svetair hayair yukte mahatis yandane sthitau madhavaha pandavas chaiva divyau shankhau prathatmatuhu. So that at that time, when Bhishma blew his conch shell, Madhava and Pandava, so both of them have come on a great chariot, which is driven by four beautiful white horses. And they started blowing their conch shells. And their conch shells are Divyau Shankhau Prathatmatuhu. Divya Shankha means they are very divine conch shells, transcendental or transcendental conch shells. So now you see, Krishna was coming on the chariot, as a chariot driver of Arjuna. So this indicates Krishna's Bhakta Vatsalya. You know what is Bhakta Vatsalya? Bhakta Vatsalya word indicates that Krishna loves his devotees. Krishna has great affection for his devotees. That's what Bhakta Vatsalya means. So now Krishna, out of his love for his devotee Arjuna, he became chariot driver of Arjuna. Now there is one story. Okay, so there was a great minister called Gladstone, right? He was a great British minister. So once this minister, somebody came to meet this minister. Some parliament member came to meet this minister, and now somebody, so the secretary said that we should wait. He is doing a very important work. Okay. So you can meet him, he's very busy now. Then he kept waiting for a long time. The minister is not coming only. Then he just peeped inside. What's the minister doing? So he has seen inside. The minister was carrying his grandson on his back and the minister has become a horse. Right? So now a small chair was sitting on the back of the minister and the minister was crawling on his knees. Right? With his hands and knees, he was crawling, and the grandchild was sitting on the back and enjoying horse riding. Okay. After giving that pleasure to the small child for some time, for a long time, then he came out to meet the secretary. Okay, what does this mean? This means love. Origin of all love is Krishna. Although Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead, still he can take any role to please his devotees, to show his affection towards his devotees, right? So just like this minister has become a horse for his grandchild, Krishna has become a chariot driver for his devotee Arjuna, like that. So now Arjuna was giving orders to Krishna. Okay, Krishna, can you please take my chariot in the middle of the two armies? Okay, so that's what warriors do. Before that, there are other things also. Let me recite these two shlokas. Panchajanyam Hrishikesho Devadattam Dhananjayah Paundram Dadhau Mahashankham Bhimakarma Mrukodarah Anantavijayam Raja Kunti Putro Yudhishthirah Nakulahasah Devascha Sughoshamani Pushpakau Panchajanyam Hrishikesho. So, conscious also have names. Okay, very interesting. Hrishikesha refers to Krishna. Okay, why Krishna is called Hrishikesha? Because he is the master of our senses. So now you don't have to know so much, but just this one small point, let's try to discuss. Krishna has so many names. Just now we saw Krishna is called as Madhava. Now Krishna is called Hrishikesha. After some time, Arjuna calls Krishna as Achyuta. Like that, in Bhagavad Gita, you see Krishna is addressed with so many names, Madhava, Achyuta, Madhusudana, like that, so many names. So we may have only one name, okay? Any child you pick up, you have only one name. Maybe you have a pet name, second name, okay? But Krishna has unlimited names. And all the names of Krishna are according to Krishna's activities. For example, Krishna appeared as the son of Yashoda Mata. All of you know this, right? That's why Krishna is called Yashoda Nandan. And Krishna lifted Govardhan mountain. That's why Krishna is called Giridhari or Govardhanadhari. Fine. And Krishna appeared as the son of Nanda Maharaj. So Krishna is called Nanda Nandan. So Krishna gets so many names according to his activities and his qualities. Krishna is very attractive. That's why he's called Krishna. The very word Krishna means he is very attractive. Fine. So Krishna has so many names, and that Krishna blew a conch shell named Panchajanya. Krishna, the name of Krishna's conch shell is Panchajanya. And Arjuna's conch shell has a name called Devadatta. And Bhima's conch shell is called Paundra. And Yudhishthira Maharaj's conch shell is called Anantavijaya. Nakula's conch shell is called Sughosha. Sahadev's conch shell is called Manipushpaka. Okay, if you cannot remember all these names, it's okay, absolutely no problem. Okay, but we can see here that when Pandavas blew their conch shells, the hearts of Kauravas got shattered. They became very fearful. They were frightened. So Krishna is blowing conch shell. Then all Pandavas were blowing their conch shells. Hearing these conch shells, the hearts of Duryodhan, Dushyasan, Karna, Shakuni, and all the other people on Kaurava's side, they became very fearful. Okay, so because Krishna is on the side of Pandavas and Pandavas are devotees, definitely there is victory for the Pandavas. And demoniac people, non-devotees, they have to become fearful of devotees. Okay, so that's the meaning here. Now, let's get into the fourth section. Arjuna became confused after seeing the armies. Okay, and one more small point here. Kapidhvaja. Arjuna had a great chariot. On that chariot, there is a nice flag. On that flag, you can see Hanumanji. All of you know Hanuman, right? So Hanuman is a great devotee of Lord Ramachandra. So Hanumanji also was along with Arjuna to bless him. He was sitting right on his chariot to bless him. And this Hanumanji also roars, right? Very fiercely, Hanumanji roars. When Bhima also roars, right? Whenever Bhima becomes very angry while killing some opponents, so along with Bhima, Hanumanji joins and then he also roars. Okay, so that's about Hanumanji and his flag. So now Arjuna said that, my dear Achyuta, can you please take the chariot in the middle of two armies? So this is the time to begin the war. When conch shells were being blown, that indicates that war is beginning, right? So at the beginning of the war, he just, and Arjuna even picked up his bow and arrows and he was about to shoot the arrows. At this time, Arjuna says, my dear Achyuta, O Krishna, can you please take the chariot in the middle of two armies? Then Krishna followed the instruction of Arjuna as a chariot driver, and he took the chariot in the middle of the two armies. Two armies were on either side and Krishna took there. Now, this question also doesn't make much sense. Okay. Now, this is the time to fight. It's not the time to see who is there. It's not that Arjuna doesn't know who is there. On the other side, this Duryodhan was there, Bhishma was there, Karna was there, Drona was there, Dushyasan, Karna, Shakuni, all these people were there. And on the other side, Yudhishthir, Nakula, Bhima, Arjuna, Drupada, so many such warriors are there. So Arjuna knows who have assembled on the war field. But still, Arjuna wanted to see them once. That means Arjuna is confused. Arjuna is not prepared to fight in the war. For example, just imagine, suppose a bridegroom has selected a bride and it is a marriage day. And marriage hall is very nicely decorated. All the relatives have arrived there and the marriage was about to begin. And the bridegroom is asked to come on the dais so that the marriage can begin. The rituals can begin. The priest is calling. Okay. And the bridegroom says, I want to see the bride once. Then I will decide whether to marry or not. Now, this is not the time. This is not the time to decide all that. Right? Decision has to be taken much before only. It's the time to just go and do it. Go ahead and do it. So similarly, whatever discussions and decisions have to be taken, that has to be done before only. Now it's already all the warriors are there on the war field and conscience were also blown and they just have to shoot the arrows and kill each other. But at this time, at this moment of crisis, Arjuna says, I want to see who all have assembled on the battle, right? That means Arjuna is not prepared to fight. He was quite confused, bewildered. He was thinking whether it is correct to fight or not. Okay. So that's the confusion of Arjuna. So Arjuna was thinking that there are so many relatives. You see this. Arjuna sees his relatives. There are fathers like Bhurishrava. There were grandfathers like Bhishma and Somadatta. And there were teachers like Dronacharya and Kripacharya. And he also saw his uncles like Shalya and Shakuni. If you don't know many of these names, it's fine. No problem. Don't worry. And he has also seen his brothers like Duryodhan, Vikarna and others. He has seen his sons like Lakshmana Kumara and other people. He has seen his grandsons. He has seen his friends like Ashwatthama. He saw his fathers-in-law like Drupada. He saw his well-wishers like Kritavarma. So he has seen so many of his relatives. And he was thinking, my God, am I going to kill all these people? So Arjuna was completely bewildered. He was thinking, how can I kill my own relatives? How can I kill my brothers and sons and grandfathers and teachers? Is it appropriate to kill them? So now I have two questions for you. Number one, is killing bad? Number two, is killing relatives bad? Okay. So first is, let's analyze. Is killing bad? Of course, killing is bad. No doubt about it. But sometimes killing is required. Okay. For example, a Kshatriya has to uphold the law and order. Now, here are some people who have done so many atrocities. Atrocities means they have attacked Pandavas in various ways. Kauravas have attacked Pandavas. They tried to kill Pandavas. They have taken their property, their kingdom. Okay. And they have also tried to insult Draupadi. They kept Pandavas in a house and set fire to the house. Right. So Pandavas were subjected to so many difficulties by the mischievous Kauravas. So they are supposed to be killed. And on top of it, he was a Kshatriya. Kshatriya means administrative class. So they're rulers. So Kshatriyas are supposed to punish people who do some mistakes, right? On top of it, you see, this war was sanctioned by Krishna personally. Whatever Krishna does is right. Whatever God plans is perfect. Okay. So now by Krishna's plan only, all the Pandavas have assembled on the war field and they were prepared to fight. Okay. Krishna directed it. So Arjuna should not have any doubts here, but still he had doubts. Now let's see. I'll tell you one small story. So once there was a king. Okay. And he had a favorite minister. Okay. So the king and the minister went to the forest just for some excursion. Okay. Just for some fun. They went to the forest. And somehow in the forest, the king had an injury. He has cut his little finger. Okay. So the little finger was cut. Then the minister said that whatever God does is perfect. Okay. Whatever Krishna does is for our good. The king became very angry. You are praising God now? You are saying that whatever God does is good for us? I have lost my finger and without any compassion, you are saying that God is great and God has done this for my good. Now, what kind of person you are? And the king became so angry on the minister and king told the minister, you get into the prison cell. He imprisoned him. So next day, again, the king went to the forest just for some fun, for excursion. But this time, minister was not there with him. Because minister was in the jail. Fine? You understood the story till now? Now, when the king went deep into the forest, there were some tribals. Okay, the tribals attacked the king. And the tribals wanted to take the king and sacrifice the king. Sacrificing means cutting the king's head. Means killing the king just as a part of their worship, tribal worship. So they were about, the head priest of the tribals, they were about to chop off the head of the king. The king was just caught up in the middle of the forest. No one was there to protect him. So he was about to die. But suddenly, one of the tribals noticed that the king does not have little finger. Okay. King's little finger was cut. So he is not fit to be offered as a sacrifice. So only a perfect body can be offered as sacrifice to Kali or whatever, their tribal devata. Okay. So they all felt that, no, let's not kill the king. And the king was released. Then the king came back to the kingdom and asked the minister and told the minister, minister, what you said is correct. Whatever God does is for our good. Because I lost my little finger yesterday, today these tribal people did not kill me. That saved my life today. So then minister said, whatever God does is for our good. But king had a doubt. My dear minister, by God's grace, my finger was cut and because of which I am saved today. So whatever God does is good for me. But how is it good for you? You have unnecessarily, you were thrown into the jail, right? I just put you in the prison. So how is it good for you? Okay, how did you accept that Krishna has done something good for you today? Then the minister said, although you have imprisoned me, although you have put me in jail, that is also good for me only. And minister, when he said like this, king was surprised. How is it good for you? Then the minister said, if you have not put me in jail, I would have accompanied you to the forest today. And because all my body parts were intact, these tribal people would have sacrificed me. Okay. So basically we need to understand that whatever Krishna does is for our good. And he has a perfect plan in doing things. So all the Kauravas and Pandavas have assembled and only by Krishna's instruction, under Krishna's guidance only, these Pandavas were fighting. So now Arjuna should not have any doubts ideally. But Arjuna had 100 doubts. He was thinking that, how can I kill my relatives, right? So his killing is bad. And Arjuna gives 4 reasons why he should not fight. He was so totally bewildered. That's the last section. With this, we will conclude. So Arjuna says that, drishtvemam svajanam Krishna युयुत्सुं समुपस्थितं सीदन्ति मम गात्राणि मुखं च परिशुष्यति. सो अर्जुन सेड दैट कृष्णा, आई एम सीइंग माय रिलेटिव्स एंड आई एम ओवरवेलम्ड विद कंपैशन. माय लिम्स वर क्विवरिंग, माय माउथ इज ड्राइंग अप, माय बॉडी इज ट्रेम्बलिंग, माय हेयर्स वर स्टैंडिंग ऑन एंड, माय बो गांडीव बो इज स्लिपिंग फ्रॉम माय हैंड्स, माय स्किन इज बर्निंग, आई कैनॉट स्टैंड हियर एनी मोर, माय माइंड इज रीलिंग. सो आई ओनली सी कॉजेस ऑफ मिसफॉर्च्यून, आई कैनॉट सी एनी गुड कमिंग आउट of this war, this battle. So please don't force me to fight in this war. I cannot fight here anymore. So Arjuna was confused. Actually, to kill one's relatives is not correct, okay, but if the relatives happen to be very sinful, a kshatriya may not hesitate to even punish the relatives also. One should not have partiality. Oh, these are my relatives. Duryodhan is my cousin, is my brother. So how can I kill him? But Duryodhan tried to kill Pandavas 100 times. What about that? So Krishna wanted to establish dharma on this earth. He wanted these demonic people like Duryodhan, Dushasan, Karna, Shakuni and all their supporters to die. And he was engaging Pandavas to kill all these miscreants. Thus, Arjuna should not have any doubts, but Arjuna is having so many doubts. He was overwhelmed with compassion. Okay, so that's the first reason Arjuna gave why he cannot fight. First, he was overwhelmed with compassion. Second reason he gives, my dear Krishna, even if I win in this battle also, I don't see any enjoyment here. First thing he said that I have no desire for kingdom. Why? Because even if I kill my relatives and get the kingdom, I cannot enjoy without relatives. Okay. So without relatives, how can I enjoy? Like sometimes there is a desire that when you get a new toy, okay, parents give you a new toy to play with, right? So when you get a new toy, you want to show the toy to a few friends and then they also feel appreciative of your toy and your good fortune, and they also appreciate you, and you feel a sense of happiness, right? But you are given a toy and you are asked to play alone. You are not allowed to meet any other friends. So the enjoyment while you are playing with the toy alone is not as much as the enjoyment when you are playing with the toy along with few friends. So Arjuna says that if I kill all my relatives, and if relatives die, if I get the kingdom also, how can I enjoy without my relatives? So there is happiness when all people are together, right? If some people die, if some relatives die, how can I alone enjoy? So there is no enjoyment even if I win also. So I have absolutely no desire for kingdom. I can even go out and beg on the streets to maintain livelihood. As a kshatriya, Arjuna is supposed to rule. The kshatriyas are supposed to rule. That is their duty. But Arjuna feels that I don't want to rule. I will go out and beg like brahmanas, right? So that is to that degree, Arjuna was completely confused in performing his duty as a kshatriya. So a kshatriya's duty is to punish demonic people, miscreants, and if needed, he has to fight with other kshatriyas also. But Arjuna is feeling so confused now. Now, Arjuna is giving third reason. So you understood, right? First reason is Arjuna was compassionate on his relatives. Second reason is Arjuna feels that there is no enjoyment even if I win. Third reason that he gave why he cannot fight is he was fearful of sin. Although they are aggressors. Aggressors means those who unnecessarily cause difficulty to others. Okay. Although Kauravas are aggressors, they try to take away our kingdom. They tried to kill us in various ways. They attacked us with weapons and they also set fire to our house. In this way, they have done so many mistakes. They have done so many offenses, towards us. But still, if we kill them, it's like we are repeating the same mistake that they are doing. So these greedy people cannot see that there is some fault in killing relatives. But we see, we are not greedy. So Arjuna says, I am not greedy for the kill my own relatives just for the sake of kingdom. So it's not worth killing one's own family members just to enjoy the kingdom. My dear Krishna, please don't force me to fight. I cannot fight. So Arjuna gives this third reason. I am fearful of sinful reactions. Right? If I kill my relatives, I may incur sin. We need to understand here that when Arjuna is fighting under the instruction of Krishna, who is the Supreme God, definitely he will not incur any sin. Okay, but Arjuna is just out of his confusion. He is feeling that I might incur sin. So please don't force me to fight with my own relatives. Okay. So now the last reason in this chapter, with this we should conclude. Arjuna says that if so many people die in the battle, if families are destroyed, the effects are very worse. So if a family is destroyed, the family traditions will stop. So now so many soldiers will come on the battle. Okay. So these soldiers will fight with the enemies and they may lose their lives also. They may die in the battle. Fine. So this destruction of these so many men, soldiers, will make their family members orphans. Okay. Now these heads of family, for example, father dies in the battle. Okay. What will happen to the wife? What will happen to the children? What will happen to other family members? Because as a father, as a responsible father, the father is supposed to run the traditions in the family traditions, right? He is supposed to make sure that the family traditions don't stop. But if the father is not there to guide the family traditions and the pujas and rituals and worship, that will stop. And also religion increases. Children will get spoiled because there is no guidance from the father. All load comes on mother itself, right? So to maintain the children, so children may get spoiled and they may not worship the Lord. So in this way, they become more degraded. So if we kill so many soldiers on the battle, so many men only will come. Women will not come to fight there, right? So many men die means so many mothers will lose their children, lose their sons. So many wives will lose their husbands. So many daughters and sons will lose their fathers. So when so many men are killed in the battle, their families will be in great pain. So I don't want to destroy the family traditions. I don't want to see those family members of these soldiers undergo so many troubles like this. In this way, Arjuna gave four reasons, right? Arjuna gave four reasons why he cannot fight in this war. Number one, he was compassionate on his relatives. Number two, he thinks that there is no enjoyment even if I win. Number three, he was fearful of sinful reactions. Number four, he is also concerned that the family traditions will be destroyed if I kill. Okay. Now, Arjuna is confused, and instead of being a friend of Krishna, Arjuna says, Krishna, I accept you as my teacher. Please guide me. I am confused. What am I supposed to do? So Arjuna's duty as a Kshatriya is to fight, but Arjuna is confused about doing his duty. So Arjuna had his duty and we all have our duties. And while doing our duties, sometimes we may also get confused, right? Whenever we are confused in performing our duties, we should take shelter of a teacher, a guide, a mentor. And Arjuna's fortune is Krishna is directly his teacher and mentor and guide. And we have our own mentors and guides. So when we are confused, we should take support from some teacher. So Arjuna made his friend as his teacher and he presented all his confusions and doubts. And he said, my dear Krishna, I better be killed unarmed. Means I will give up my weapons. I will just stand on the battlefield and let these Kauravas come and kill me. Right? I will not protest. I will not defend myself. I shall not fight. So in this way, Arjuna gave up his fighting. So today we have seen these five topics. The first topic we have seen today was Dhritarashtra's inquiry to Sanjaya. Second topic, Duryodhana compared Pandava's army and Kaurava's army. And we have seen how so many warriors were blowing their conch shells, and these conch shell blowing was like signs of Pandava's victory. And we have seen Arjuna, how he was confused. And we also have seen Arjuna's four reasons for not fighting in this battle of Kurukshetra. So Arjuna gave these four reasons and said, "I cannot fight, my dear Lord." So now we need to understand one very important thing. Now chapter is completed. The class is also completed. So with these few comments, I'll conclude and you can all ask questions. So a very important lesson, message that we need to take home today based on this first chapter of Bhagavad Gita is that now Arjuna was in confusion and then he surrendered to a teacher and the teacher will guide him, Krishna will guide him. Similarly, whenever we are confused in our life, a teacher will help us, and mainly Krishna will help us through the teachings of Bhagavad Gita. Although Krishna was speaking Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna, through Arjuna, Krishna is speaking Bhagavad Gita to all of us. Okay? So Arjuna doesn't need to know Bhagavad Gita. Arjuna was already a pure devotee of Krishna. He is a direct associate of Krishna. Arjuna is not confused in a literal sense. Yes, Arjuna is confused. Okay? But his confusion is an indication of our confusion. Sometimes you see in television, you must have seen interviews. For example, an anchor, an interviewer is interviewing a big doctor. Okay. So when this problem comes, what kind of medicine we are supposed to take? Now the interviewer is asking these questions to the doctor, and the doctor is giving solutions. So now interviewer is asking so many questions to the doctor, that does not mean interviewer has all those diseases, right? On behalf of so many patients, the interviewer is asking these questions to the doctor. Similarly, Arjuna is confused and he is asking so many questions to Krishna in Bhagavad Gita. That does not mean Arjuna does not know the answers to these questions. Arjuna knows answers to all these questions because he is a pure devotee of Krishna. But still, through this conversation between Krishna and Arjuna, we get to know all these answers. How to worship Krishna, how to do things right, what is good, what is bad, all that we will be able to understand only when we understand Bhagavad Gita from Krishna. So now, very important thing, why only Krishna's Bhagavad Gita is given so much prominence? Because Krishna is the Supreme Lord. There may be so many gods. You see Ganesh ji, then Shiva, Indra, Chandra, Varuna, Vayu, Brahma, Agni. We have seen so many forms of worshipable forms, right? Kali, Durga, so many gods are there. So they are all called devatas. Okay. Now, for example, in a country, there is one president and all others are ministers. Okay, in a country, in a state, you say there is home minister, there is education minister, there is agriculture minister, there is finance minister. Like that, there are so many ministers in a country or in a kingdom. They take care of those departments, right? But the president is one. Similarly, in this universe also, there are so many devatas, 33 crore devatas are there. But the supreme God, supreme president is Krishna. For example, fire department is given to Agni Devata. Okay. And creation department is given to Brahma. Destruction department is given to Shiva. Education department is given to Saraswati Devi. Right. And finance department, money, that is given to Kubera. So like that, giving light to the whole universe, that department is given to sun and moon. So like the different devatas take care of different aspects of the universe, how to run the universe. But the boss of all these devatas is Krishna. He's the supreme God and all others are his subordinate gods, right? So that's why Krishna is the supreme Lord. When he teaches Bhagavad Gita, when he's directly giving us spiritual teachings, they are very relevant, very important for us to understand. Okay. So I hope all of you could get a glimpse of what the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita teaches all of us. So now with this, I will conclude. It's 6:05 now. So if you have any questions, you can ask.
Prabhuji, there are a few questions on the chat box.
Yeah.
Would you like to take it up yourself or should we?
Yes, Mataji. Let me just see those questions.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Okay, if Arjuna had grandsons and grandfathers, then how old are the grandfathers? Okay, so Arjuna himself is a grandfather. Arjuna had this grandfather, who is that Bhishma. So they are definitely few hundred years old. I think Bhishma lived almost 400 years or something like that, right? In those days, people used to live so many years, right? In fact, in the previous, now maximum 100 years we live in this Kali Yuga. In the previous Yuga, people used to live for 1000 years. That is in Dwapar Yuga. In Treta Yuga, people used to live for 10,000 years. In Satya Yuga, people used to live for 1 lakh years. Okay. Like that, the lifespan varies. And this whole Mahabharata, this Krishna's activities and Pandava's activities were happening somewhere towards the end of Dwapar Yuga. So people were long lived at that time. Okay. So, so many questions are coming. My God. Okay. I will go from top and then take from top. Okay. These are all greetings. Questions by Dhritarashtra complain. Okay. This is just a summary that one child has posted. Can you say the names of Duryodhana's army? Okay. In Duryodhana's army, the main warrior was Bhishma. The next Drona, then Karna, then Vikarna. Vikarna is one of the brothers of Duryodhana only. And Duryodhana's remaining 99 brothers were also part of his army. Shakuni, then Dushyasana was also there in the part of his army. So these are some prominent names. Ashwatthama was also a prominent name. Then what other questions? Why is the battlefield where Gita was recited known as Kurukshetra? It's the name of the place. Okay. It's the name of the place. It's a holy place called Kurukshetra. And whenever there is some eclipse and all, several people from different parts of the universe will assemble there to perform some holy rituals and all. And near Kurukshetra only, this Parashuram, an incarnation of the Lord, has dug 5 wells, right? 5 ponds. Then, how do we know that Krishna is the Lord? I spoke this in the end of the presentation that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. He is the origin of everything. Anyways, this is the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita only. By the time we reach 10th chapter, you will completely be convinced that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of God. So there are several chapters that prove that Krishna is the Supreme Lord based on Bhagavad Gita only. So just stay tuned. He will understand how Krishna is the Supreme Lord. So he is the Supreme Lord. He is the origin of everybody and everything in the entire universe. And all other people are his servants. That's what our scriptures teach us. He is the origin of even Mahavishnu also. Okay. If Arjuna knows the answers to the questions, why did he go to the extent of not fighting the war? Yes, by Krishna's desire, by Krishna's will only, Arjuna was asking all these questions. For example, a teacher may write on the board A, B, C, D to teach some nursery children. Okay, how to write A, how to write B, how to write C. So does it mean that the teacher does not know how to write A, B, C, D? Just to teach small children, the teacher is also writing ABCD. Teacher is also saying 1 plus 1 equal to 2, 3 minus 2 equal to 1. And when the children are reciting tables, 2 ones are 2, 2 twos are 4, 2 threes are 6, etc., the teacher also may do repeat. So just to teach the children. Similarly, Arjuna, by Krishna's will, Arjuna is asking so many questions on behalf of all of us. The questions that we might get Arjuna is guessing and then asking these questions so that Krishna can give authentic answers to all of us and enlighten us. Okay. Why is the battlefield where Gita was recited not to the sacred scripture? Why Krishna chosen to be charioteer, taking orders of Arjuna, and he has other demigods doing the other duties? So why not demigods being the charioteer to take orders instead of the Supreme Lord? That's affection. Okay. For example, Krishna had how many queens? 16,108 queens Krishna had. Okay. And each queen had a palace, very, very big palace. And each queen had hundreds of maid servants. Okay. So still, all these queens personally serve Krishna. They personally render service to Krishna. That Rukmini comes and then does chamar and vyajan to Krishna. So why does she do it? Love. Now there are 9 lakh cows in Nanda Maharaj's Goshala. All of you know Damodar Leela, right? Damodar Leela, everybody knows. So there are 9 lakh cows in Krishna's Goshala. To take milk from 9 lakh cows and to make it into yogurt and to churn buttermilk and take out butter, how many maid servants are needed? Mother Yashoda's house is filled with hundreds of maid servants. But although there are hundreds of maid servants, Mother Yashoda was personally churning milk for Krishna. Why? So why is she personally churning milk for buttermilk for Krishna, taking out butter for Krishna? Because of her love, motherly love. Similarly, although Krishna has hundreds and thousands of servants, he is personally driving the chariot of his dear friend Arjuna because of love, because of affection. It's pure love. Krishna is directly taking up the role of a chariot driver because of love for Arjuna. Okay, next. Does Krishna mean to say that revenge for dharma is necessary? It's not about revenge. Okay, although, for example, a student does mischief and the teacher might scold the student or maybe give some penalty or punishment to the student. Okay. So does it mean the teacher is taking revenge? Definitely not. So being a genuine well-wisher of the student, sometimes a teacher might become little heavy with the student. Being a genuine well-wisher of a child, sometimes mother may scold the child or become little strict with the child. Okay, but that is not revengeful thoughts. Similarly, to rectify the wrong mentality of some people, sometimes God and his devotees might punish such people. Okay, now you see, Duryodhan, after the entire Kurukshetra war, Duryodhan was lying in a pool of blood because this Bhima just defeated Duryodhan and Duryodhan just fell down there. But Krishna felt so compassionate seeing Duryodhan. Krishna felt that, oh, this Duryodhan, I gave him several opportunities to rectify his mentality, but still Duryodhan did not take those opportunities. Duryodhan is still having selfish mentality. So Krishna felt very compassionate. Krishna felt concerned about Duryodhan because God or his great devotees never mean to take revenge on sinful people. But those sinful people must be punished at least to some degree so that they can give up their sinful propensities, right? Just to rectify their mentality, just to bring some transformation in their heart, just to make them good, sometimes God has to punish, Krishna has to punish them, his devotees have to punish them. So that's a necessity rather than a revengeful attitude. When the Lord punishes somebody, a sinful person, it's not out of revenge, it's not out of envy, it's not out of grudge, it's not out of hatred, it is purely out of love. Sometimes love has to be expressed in a certain way that maybe that may look a little harsh, but that love has to be expressed in that way. Because that person who loves the sinful person wants to see a transformation in that sinful person. So that's why Krishna sometimes have to punish. Okay, next. Can you provide the PDF of the Bhagavad Gita Subodhini you are talking about? Okay, this Gita Subodhini ebook is available. Okay, maybe one of our devotees might post, one of our coordinates we can post the link there. Does Krishna mean to say that revenge for them? Okay. Krishna mean to say. Why didn't Krishna just look at the Kauravas and make them understand that it's not right and fight? Very intelligent question. Okay. Okay. Krishna can hypnotize. Even ordinary hypnotizers in this world also might change our mind. They can do some magic and then make us do what they want us to do. Isn't it? Even ordinary hypnotizers also can do. Can't Krishna do? Definitely he can do. So Krishna can hypnotize Kauravas and bring about a positive transformation in all of them. He has that ability, but he does not do that. Why he doesn't do that? Krishna doesn't want personal love. For example, I need water. Okay. Now, this devotee who is sitting next to me here, okay, if I say I need water, if he lovingly brings water and gives me, I'm happy to drink it. But if that person is not happy to bring water, right, he will just get water and then throw it on my table and drink it. Right, he will just throw it on my face. He's very reluctant to do it. He is forced to do it. He's obliged to do it. Right, he's not happy to do it. I don't feel like drinking that water, isn't it? Although he's giving me that service, there's no love there. There's only force there. He's obliged to. How many times you will ask me water? So people may have different degrees of love. Okay. So Krishna doesn't want forced love. Similarly, if we voluntarily on our own, if we go and offer something to Krishna, Krishna is happy to receive that service. If you pluck a flower on your own and offer it to Krishna, Krishna is so happy with your love and affection. But if somebody is taking a stick and beating you behind, if you don't offer to Krishna, you will go to hell, right? So and Krishna himself, you offer flowers to me. You become good. You do like this, you do like that. If Krishna forces all of us to worship him or to come to a good behavior, it actually doesn't, that the kind of good behavior or love or so-called service attitude that we exhibit out of force is not pleasing to Krishna, right? So Krishna does not want forced love. That's why although he has the ability to force all of us to become his devotees and make us good, Krishna doesn't force us. Krishna inspires us. Krishna doesn't impose. Krishna does not force us to love him. Krishna does not force us. He will only inspire us through his devotees, through the scriptures, through the acharyas, and he personally comes as an incarnation and he gives teachings personally. Right? If we voluntarily take those teachings and develop an inspiration to love him and serve him, Krishna is very happy to receive that service. Because Krishna doesn't want forced love and forced service. He doesn't force him. That's why Krishna went and lovingly told Duryodhan, Duryodhan, please stop this fight. Just give the kingdom, rightful kingdom back to Pandavas. But Duryodhan did not agree. Then Krishna said, okay, fine, no problem. You are not agreeing voluntarily. We have to punish you. We have to deal with you in a different way. It's like that. Okay. Krishna doesn't like to force. Oh, there are so many things. There are 99 plus new messages. I don't know how am I going to say, go through all this.
Maybe we can just ask the relevant questions, Prabhuji.
Yes, Mataji. Maybe you can ask. Yes. Or someone can ask. They can go through.
Yeah. Yash Prabhu, are you there? Maybe I'll only ask.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, whoever.
So, there are some irrelevant questions also.
Shall we open for the devotees to ask themselves?
Prabhuji, the children, if unmuted, are going to take a long time to answer one question.
Yeah, no problem.
So there is one child we can unmute, Naman Pandey. He's been requesting to unmute because he has a long question, he says. So
yes, Naman Pandey. Prabhu, please.
Thank you.
Prabhuji, I have two questions. One is that you said that in Dwapar, in Treta Yuga, people live for 10,000 years, but the father of Ram, Dasharath Maharaj, he lived for 60,000 years. And the second question is that when Arjun asked the question that which he knew the answer of, why didn't Krishna answer it? Why didn't he just say, you know the question, why you are asking, come on?
Okay, fine. Very good questions. First, in Satyayuga, people used to live for 1 lakh years. In Treta Yuga, little lesser. This is 100, 1,000, 10,000, yes. So, although the general lifespan of people, human beings, in a Yuga is mentioned in the scriptures, there are some exceptions. For example, Priyavrata Maharaj, in Bhagavatam 5th canto, there's a story of Priyavrata Maharaj. Priyavrata Maharaj had 3 sons. He had so many sons. Out of them, 3 sons were there. Uttama, Tamasa, Raivata. They lived for 3 Manvantaras. They became the Manus of the next 3 Manvantaras. Manvantara means a phase of time during which Manu rules. Okay, let me not give you so many technical explanations here. But in short, the answer to your first question is, there are exceptions. Although the general lifespan of human beings in one yuga is set in number, as mentioned in the scriptures, there are some people who lived much, much, much more than that lifespan also. They lived across different yugas, right? They not only across different yugas, they lived for more than several yuga cycles. Okay, so that's the exception. Then second question is, if Arjuna had already knew several answers to the questions that he's asking, why did Krishna answer those questions? Because, as I said in the class also, Arjuna is asking questions on our behalf. I gave the example of TV interviewer, right? The TV interviewer is asking so many questions to a doctor so that he can give some medical solutions to the audiences. Sometimes the interviewer also might know answers to the questions, but she or he wants the doctor, the physician, to give authentic answers for the information of the audiences who are watching that show, right? So it's not about knowing or not knowing. It's more about providing an authentic information to the entire humanity. So that's why through the conversation between Krishna and Arjuna in Bhagavad Gita, or Sukadeva Goswami and Parikshit Maharaj in Bhagavatam, or Narada Muni and Yudhishthira Maharaj in Bhagavatam. Like that, there are so many great personalities who discuss amongst themselves, right? Through their discussions, we get to know many things because those discussions are recorded in our scriptures. So we get to know so many lessons. Does it make sense, Prabhu?
Yeah, Prabhuji. There's another child who wants to be unmuted. Just a minute, Prabhuji. In the meanwhile, Prabhuji, there's a child who asks this question. When Krishna was reciting the Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna, could everyone hear what he was saying?
Okay, could everyone hear?
Yeah, what Krishna was speaking.
So those who had that pure consciousness could manage to hear. Otherwise, it's a conversation between Krishna and Arjuna only. Right? Not everyone could access this conversation at that moment of time. But those who had pure consciousness definitely can hear that.
Thank you, Rabbi. There's a question from Tanush. Yes, go ahead, Tanush.
Sir, why did they choose to fight on the battlefield called Kurukshetra, not on other battlefields?
It's a religious place. It's a dharmic place. It's a holy place. That's why they have decided that place, right? Why not other battlefields? Because this kind of question can come for everything that happened. Okay. So they have made the decision. Okay. And it's definitely a holy place. That's why they have made the decision there. Any other question?
Prabhuji, one child asks that why didn't Hanuman ji personally fight on the Pandava side?
Okay, very good question. Why Hanuman ji did not personally fight? Actually, if Hanuman ji comes, there's no fight only. He can smash entire Kaurava's army in just one moment only. Why? That as a big war need not happen. So now, okay, that's just a small thing. Krishna wants to give prominence to his devotees at different times. In Ramayan, Hanuman was made hero. Okay, Hanuman just jumped across Lanka ocean and then found out Sita Devi. He has burned the whole Lanka. He has come back to Lord Ramachandra and gave the news about Sita Devi. And again accompanied Lord Ram to Lanka, and then he killed so many great warriors from Ravana's side. So Hanumanji was given full prominence in Ramayana, in that yuga, during Lord Ramachandra's pastimes. But now Krishna wanted to give more importance to other devotees. In a movie, or in a video, or in a drama, every scene will not have the same, actors, right? There may be some, 50 scenes in a drama. So in one scene, there are some characters who speak more, who have more dialogues, who has more things to speak. In another scene, other people will take over. Similarly, different devotees of Krishna get prominence at different times. Now, during Mahabharata, Krishna wanted to make Arjuna and Bhima the heroes. And during Ramayana time, Ram made Hanumanji the hero. For example, you see, yesterday only we celebrated Narasimha Chaturthasi. Okay. So when Narasimha Dev appeared after killing Hiranyakashipu, all the devatas came, Yakshas, Kinnaras, Kimpurushas, then Gandharvas, and several sages. So many people have come to offer prayers to Narasimha Dev. When they offered prayers to Narasimha Dev, did Narasimha Dev get satisfied? Was he pacified? No. So when did Narasimha Dev get pacified? Only when Prahalad offered his prayers, isn't it? Now Brahma was there, Shiva was there, Narada was there, so many other great devotees were there. None of their prayers could satisfy Narasimha Dev, because Krishna, and even Lakshmi also could not come closer to Narasimha Dev, right? But the Lord wanted to give more prominence to Prahlad at this time. So only when Prahlad went forward, Narasimha Dev was satisfied. And now Prahlad is made more prominent in this context. But in the next canto of Bhagavatam, 8th canto, we see that Bali Maharaj gets more prominence. Prahlad is playing a side role there. Right? He takes a low profile. So Bali Maharaj was being dealt in a certain way by Vamanadev, and Prahlad is just standing there. Okay. Prahlad is just standing there and then offering few prayers. But in the whole pastime of Vamanadev, Bali Maharaj took so much prominence. In the whole pastime of Narasimhadev, Prahlad took prominence. In Mahabharata, Krishna wanted to make Arjuna and Bhima the heroes. In Ramayana, Hanumanji was the hero. So like the different devotees take prominent roles in Krishna's pastimes according to the Lord's desire. Right? It's not that one devotee is only highlighted in every single pastime of the Lord. Does it make sense, Prabhu? Whoever has asked that?
Yeah, sure, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, there's one more question. Why did Dronacharya and Bhishma support the Kauravas?
Okay, so Bhishma has taken a vow to protect the throne of Hastinapur. Okay, so he was obliged. Okay, but that's only an external reason. But the main reason is Krishna wanted to give a very, very important message to the entire humanity through Bhishma or Drona, of course. The message is, however powerful you may be as great a warrior as Bhishma or Drona, or you may be as pure as a devotee as Bhishma. So Bhishma is not only a great warrior, he's also a pure devotee of Krishna. He's a Mahajan, right? He's one of the prominent world devotees of Krishna. But still, he was defeated in Kurukshetra war. So Krishna wanted to give this important teaching to all of us that however great you may be, if you stand on the side of adharma, you have to be defeated. So Krishna wanted to give this message to the entire humanity, and Bhishma participated in Krishna's pastime. Bhishma just acted according to the will of Krishna. Right? So by Krishna's desire only, Bhishma fought on the side of Duryodhan and apparently supported him, not at heart, but physically, just so that we get this understanding that even if a person is very great, if he takes the side of Adharma, he has to be defeated, right? Make sense, Prabhu?
Any other question? There are too many questions coming up, Prabhuji. Can we take two more? We'll just take two more, Prabhuji.
Okay.
6:30 already. Okay, there's one child who wants to be unmuted. Angel Thakur. We'll just take her question. Yes, Angel Thakur. Yeah, you can speak. Thank you.
Hare Krishna Mataji and Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
My question is that if Arjun didn't want to fight, then why did he come on the battlefield?
Oh, Arjuna actually wanted to fight. That's why he came on the battlefield. But after coming on the battlefield, and when he saw his own relatives there, he felt a little confused, bewildered. All emotions just came up. Okay. So he became quite emotional seeing his own relatives. Then he got confused. Okay. Angel Thakur, you understood?
Yes, sir.
Hari, Hari. Any other question?
Yes, Radhakun, do you want to ask? I've unmuted you.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. My question is that after the war, the Pandavas ruled for 56 years. So then why did they quit ruling? Wasn't that a dharma?
It's not 56, I think it's 36, something like that. Anyways, number doesn't matter. So actually, Krishna comes on this planet to establish dharma, to kill miscreants and to protect devotees. Fine. So we will see this in the fourth chapter. So when Krishna comes to this planet to perform these pastimes, Krishna also brings some of his devotees to participate in his pastimes. Pandavas also appeared along with Krishna to participate in his pastimes and to assist him in killing miscreants, establishing dharma and protecting devotees. When Krishna disappeared from this world, Narada Muni indicated to Pandavas that you also can plan your departure. Krishna went away from this planet, you also can go away from this planet. Okay. So Parikshit Maharaj will become the ruler. So when Pandavas enthroned Parikshit Maharaj as the ruler of Hastinapur, they are perfectly taking care of the kingdom. Right, they were also entrusting an able administrator to take care of the kingdom. So there is absolutely no adharma on their part. They retired. So this is how Rajarshis work. So a saintly king rules the kingdom very responsibly for some time. And as soon as there is an able successor, means there is another king who can take over the kingdom, as soon as he becomes ready, then they will give the kingdom to them and they will go and perform bhakti. This is how kings used to operate. Okay? Whoever has asked that question.
Thank you.
That's Radhakund, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, one child is asking, why only Arjuna Krishna chose? Why not the other Pandava?
Because Arjuna is very dear, very close to Krishna's heart. And you see, amongst the five Pandavas, Yudhishthir and Bhima are elder to Krishna. Nakula and Sahadev are younger to Krishna. But Arjuna, who is in the middle, is equal to Krishna. So when Krishna goes in front of Yudhishthir and Bhima, he offers dandavats to them. When Krishna goes in front of Nakula and Sahadev, he gives blessings to them. But when Krishna comes in front of Arjuna, he embraces him out of friendship. They are equals. So there is more friendship between Arjuna and Krishna. Secondly, their expansions are Nara and Narayana. Okay. So anyways, let me not get into so many technical reasons. So basically, Krishna and Arjuna are quite close. That does not mean that the other devotees amongst the Pandavas are any less. They are also pure devotees. Yudhishthira Maharaj is definitely a pure devotee of the Lord, right? But still, Krishna, out of his intimacy, he chose Arjuna. Any other question? Our chat box. Is Krishna the only supreme god of this universe or every universe? Of course, Krishna is the supreme god of all universes. He's the creator of all universes. Okay. Any other question? Shall we conclude here? It's 6:36 p.m.
Yeah, Prabhupada, there's one boy called Rahul. He is asking to unmute. Maybe that's the last question.
Okay.
He's been asking to be unmuted. Yes, Rahul.
Dandavat Pranam.
Dandavat Pranam, Prabhu.
I have two questions to ask.
Mm.
The first question is, battle is Kshatriya religion, but Dronacharya, Ashwatthama and Krupacharya were saints. But why they fight?
They were Brahmanas, still they fought. Because they were military teachers. Okay, although they were Brahmanas, they were teaching military science to Pandavas and Kauravas. That's why they also chose to fight. And also they were obliged to Duryodhan. Okay, they were obliged to Duryodhan to fight on his behalf. Because of their connection with Duryodhan, Duryodhan also just pulled them into fight. So that's like, and although they were Brahmanas, they were more into military education. And Ashwatthama is also kind of friend of Duryodhan. Out of friendship also he came and participated in the war.
And the second question is, why Dronacharya, Ashwatthama and Kripacharya take Duryodhana's side and not Pandava's side?
I already mentioned it in the answer to another child's question. So Duryodhan was Dronacharya was obliged to Duryodhan, and Ashwatthama, being an evil-minded person, he is already having a deep friendship with Duryodhan more than even Pandavas, right? And our Dronacharya has undue affection for his son Ashwatthama. So like that, there are all emotional connections, right? So Duryodhan is very close to Ashwatthama. Ashwatthama is very close to Duryodhan, and Dronacharya is close to Ashwatthama. So in this way, because of these emotional connections and bondings and obligations, and ultimately Krishna's will to prove that however powerful Brahmana you may be, you have to be defeated if you take the side of Adharma. Because of all these reasons, they have taken this side.
Okay, Prabhuji. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Hari Hari. So it's 6:38. Thank you. Shall we conclude, Mataji?
Prabhuji, the kids' questions will go on and on and on all night, or so you will not be able to answer. Thank you, children. Thank you so much for all your lovely questions. We'll surely take it up as and when the chapters are happening. I guess most of them will be answered, right, Prabhuji?
Yes, yes.
Sure. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Thank you very much. I thank all the children who have come for this Bhagavad Gita session, first session, and enthusiastically participated. I could not take all the questions in the chat box. There was 9900 messages. So thank you for your enthusiasm. So please continue with this enthusiasm to study Bhagavad Gita and know more and more on Krishna's heart. So today we had a lot of storyline to discuss, because this is the first chapter. Some little background of Mahabharata also we discussed. But tomorrow onwards, it is little deeper. Discussion. Krishna is going to speak now. Till now, Krishna did not speak. He hardly spoke. So in the next chapter, Krishna begins to speak. Definitely, the subject matter is going to be a little more serious, but we will try to make it simple, okay, so that even younger children, I see very small children also here, so that we understand, and we'll have to go through this learning journey in a more interesting way also. So let's meet tomorrow again at 5 p.m. Thank you very much for your participation. Hare Krishna, Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Hare Krishna.